stage, Mark Calcavecchia.
I'm sure you guys want to ask Miguel about last week.
Isn't it fun when your guests introduce themselves? Thank you all for being here for family night here at Haggin Oaks. As Mark and Miguel were both commenting, first time here, this is quite a facility, and I'm not sure that as close as we are to Sacramento that we recognize what a treasure we have in Haggin Oaks. And this place has certainly a national reputation, if not an international reputation, as a place where kids learn to play golf, where the game has grown, and where, you know, we're just every once in a while able to get a couple of incredible tour players who are wonderful personalities, and we're going to talk a little bit. And first of all, in addition to thanking the staff here at Haggin Oaks, I have to please help me in thanking everybody from Ping Golf for putting this together for us tonight. Obviously, the U.S. Senior Open is in town, and we're stamping our face for a worldwide audience, and it's going to be interesting to hear what these gentlemen who both played practice rounds think about Del Paso, what Angel thinks about last week's course. But first, let me formally introduce.
You are desperate to start talking about the last week, no?
Please, a warm round of applause for Miguel Angel Jimenez. And sitting here in the middle is a man that whose face is recognizable to everybody and has been playing golf for a number of years now, Mr. Mark Calcavecchia. Should we go backwards first? Tell me about Chambers Bay. We've heard so many things.
Well, the scenario is beautiful, really, when you get down the hills and you look down there, all the holes and the bay and the things, you know, it's what an amazing place. And then the history starts. And you start to play golf, and what a place! No, it's a really thing that they're gonna tell the good things first. And it's a very selective golf course because you need to hit perfect everything. And even like that, you can get not very happy, you know? Because sometimes when you play a links course, and Mark Calcavecchia knows about the links course, he won in Trum in 1989, I believe, no? That is when he won in Trum, the Open. Yeah. And he knows what about links course. Links course is a through golf course, but you have to use a lot of imagination because it's normally a very fast golf courses, bouncy golf courses, but you can see where the ball bounces and you miss a shot where the ball is going to lie and things, no? But last week, even you can hit a very good shot and the ball rolls. And it's a little bit unfair, no? I have to say that's very selective because it's, at the end, top names going there on the top. During 4 days, it's not about luck only, it's about the way you play. But it's tough to have a fan there, no? When you hit a good shot and the ball's going where you go, when you hit a good putt and the ball making 4 or 5 breaks that you never see there, when looks like you grow in the broccoli instead of grass, you know. It's not the first time you hear that, probably, no. But it's sad to say that, no, because when you have the grass, the Poaruna is growing a different way than the Festuca, that's growing different way. Probably when you cut the grass in the first hour of the day, everything is just rolling and things is more or less fine. But as far as they start growing different, you know, one is growing that way, the other one growing lie down, and then you don't. It's not very nice, really. But I have to say that also, you know, it's, as I say, it's very selective. It's a very punishing golf course. You see the scores. It's tough for the spectators, you know. The spectators they want to see also birdies. They don't want to see only bogeys and double bogeys. People want to cheer, people want to be fan of the golf course. And also, you want to follow the groups. There is another thing what happened there, that the people cannot follow in the middle. You can follow only 2-3 holes, I was sitting down on the stand, and that's it. And that it's not good for the public. It's not good for the, if you want to promote golf, I don't think that is the best golf course to promote and to get the golf more into the people and people getting more interested in golf. You need to have something that you can enjoy, you can share, that you can see, you can play this golf. For us, I would not pay any a dollar to go there and play.
Well, we certainly hope Sacramento provides a better opportunity You know, obviously, when the USGA sets up a course, they try to do what they can to protect the course against a score. You know, we've heard that. And at a course like Del Paso, Mark, you know, it's length and it's the rough. And you had a chance to play a practice round. What do you think of our Del Paso Country Club?
This golf course, I think, is about as exact opposite as you can get on the spectrum from last week. I wasn't there, but I watched a lot of it on TV. Obviously, I watched the whole thing. And, you know, the greens here are just, I mean, the whole course is in immaculate shape. It's just the rough is very deep for us. I don't think, as long as I've been on the Champions Tour in 5 years, I've seen rough like this. Is it working? Is it loud enough?
Yeah.
So the rough's very deep. The course is what I think is pretty long for us. Miguel's he's a really long, so he'll be a favorite. But
we've seen his warm-up routine.
Yeah, it's a stretching routine that gets him all that extra distance. But the course is awesome. It really is. It's all right in front of you. You know what to do. There's no, you don't have to ramp it off any hills. And you know, like last week, it seemed a little bit Mickey Mouse in that sense. But man, if you hit a good 6-footer here, it's going to go in. There's no guesswork here. And the course is just it's in fantastic shape. And also, like you said, for spectators, I saw last week some guy said he spent thousands of dollars for, you know, 6 tickets for his family, and after the first day, he tried to sell them all because he couldn't see a thing. It was just a terrible course for the spectators. You know, which is too bad. So, and I heard a lot of complaints about that. And, not many people getting hurt. A couple of caddies got hurt. You know, it was a tough situation there. But you know, that's not the case here. Fantastic spectating here. You can see every green, every hole. You can get right up around the greens and see everything. So, you know, hope everybody comes out. I'm sure the crowds will be great. You know, the weather's going to be perfect. It's a little warm. But you know, at least we don't have to carry the umbrellas or the rain suits, so it's gonna be nice.
You know, it's funny. Kevin Sutherland was telling me today that what he's hearing from you players is that everybody seems to really love the course, and obviously when you put last week's course against this one, you're gonna love it. But the folks at Del Paso have done a marvelous job of getting the course set up. I think.
I think they have. Again, it's as fair as it gets. You're going to have to play great here to play well. You got to do everything great. You got to drive it great, number one, because if you start hitting your driver crooked, hitting the rough, you're pretty much in bad shape. You got to your long game's got to be good because, of course, there's a lot of long holes. There's 3 really long par threes. You know, and the rough's deep around the green, so you got to have a good short game, and you know, the greens are perfect, so you're going to make some putts, but you know, a lot of them are going to be for par, so you got to have your game in shape here this week to have a chance.
You know, I saw Miguel out on the putting green today, and I was talking to him a bit because he laid down this tool that is helping him develop his stroke. And I think that's something that's really important that we all remember, that even tour professionals, you know, they go over the mechanics over and over again to make sure they've got it right. Talk about your putting session there today.
No, well, as you say, no, I got a little mat with that help you to alignment and to get you set up position, not very tense. Sometimes you don't feel the same than yesterday, and then you try to feel a little bit more sitting down, a little bit more straight. You know, nothing helps you get to maintain the position through every day, no? With a few minutes work there, and then also the path of the swing and the pace of the movement, no? And that is everything helps, no? Just don't need to spend hours just checking what you're doing normally. And then just reading, try to get the speed of the greens. That is the main thing you need to, you know, especially in big greens like you want to have this week here, and fast, that you need to have a good pace when you have a long putts. And that's the main thing you have to work on.
You're a man that appears that being comfortable is important, as evidenced by this cover at Sports Illustrated. That's a pretty comfortable pose there.
Well, that's nice. That's me.
Yes, that's you.
That's me with a big stock, with a big stogie. With a nice spot there. Well, we are in a freedom world, no? Then I love to smoke, and people like the picture, and I'll be there. Why not?
I understand that your nickname is the mechanic, and it has nothing to do with your ability to fix cars, but more to drive them fast. Is that right?
Well, before I start playing golf, I work in the garage too. When I leave the school, the early age, and the 15, I start to work in the garage, and then I start working there, and the garage had to close after that. and then I have to I come into introducing golf with my brother.
Mark, you're a pretty stylish guy too. We saw those bacon pants you were wearing a couple of weeks ago. Explain that.
Yeah, that was that kind of came out of nowhere. I have a friend in Des Moines, Iowa, who is the founder of the Blue Ribbon Bacon Festival. And early in the year, he just asked me out of nowhere, would I wear a pair of bacon pants, the first round of the Principal Charity Classic. And I said, well, you got to send me a picture of what these things look like, because usually I don't care if I look like an idiot, but, you know, so I said, sometimes I do, but so let me see what they look like. And so he sent me a picture, and I said, oh, okay, those aren't too bad. I'll wear them on Friday. So he sent me a pair, and I wore them on Friday, and it just so happened the National Pork Convention was going on in Des Moines that week. So it was a big, Iowa / Des Moines is the pork, capital of the world. They love their bacon in Iowa. So it went over really well, and I played pretty good that day. Got a little little TV time, and the next day I wore the belt. And he sent me a belt to boot. And and actually birdied 5 of the last 8 holes that day. So then I thought, well, on Sunday I was leading by 1. I got to keep some sort of bacon theme going on Sunday, because it would be stupid to kind of change the mojo. So I put on the same pants. My wife actually washed the shirt, so at least the shirt was clean. And wore the same outfit I wore on Friday, and ended up winning the tournament by 1. So it was just one of those things. And for my buddy and his bacon company, it was crazy. And he runs like 10 or 12 bacon festivals around the country, and he's got one in Iceland, crying out loud, a bacon festival in Iceland. So it kind of went over pretty good, so pretty lucky.
Now, isn't that the same tournament that you went out and just dropped into a sporting goods store and bought a new putter?
Exactly, same thing. We got there a week before. My wife and I grew up in rural Nebraska, which is only about 3.5 hour drive from there, so it's kind of my home area, so to speak. So I've always loved Iowa to boot. We got there a week early because we had the week off, and we travel around in the motorhome. And Ping does an amazing job of sending me a million putters, and I had about 40 of them in the bus. Not really any of them looked too good to me. So we went to Dick's Sporting Goods, because my wife needed to buy some running stuff, some t-shirts and stuff for her running, a new pair of shoes or something. And of course I took an immediate right and went over to the golf stuff. And the second putter I looked at was a Ping Cadence Answer 2, heavy. And I looked at it and I went, man, that looks really good. So I hit 12 putts with it on the putting green. And, sometimes those putting greens in the golf stores, you can't miss if you try. It just seems like they're, like, grooved in there, and I'm like, made 12 in a row from all kinds of different lengths. And there was an older gentleman in there, and he had no idea who I was. And he goes, you haven't missed yet. And I said, yeah, I know. I said, what do you think? Should I buy it? He goes, I think I would if I were you. I said, all right, it's a deal. I think I'm going to buy it. So I went over there and bought the thing, and again, one of those deals. And as it turns out, this is the third putter I've actually bought in a pink putter that I actually bought in a store that I won a tournament with. And one of those deals, you know. And I just, I love the putter. I'm still using it and still putting great with it.
The store will be open and the pink putters will be available if any of you want to go in there after this.
They work.
Miguel, you got a record that you keep breaking, and you're, you know, maybe the only one that can break it. You were the oldest winner on the European Tour, and then you broke that record again.
Yeah, well, I broke the record before was Desi Smith, and 3 years ago. Then I won Hong Kong. Then I won Hong Kong the next year after also, then I broke my record. Then I broke my record again last year when I won the Spanish Open, yeah.
How many hole-in-ones you made this year? Three?
And this year I make three hole-in-ones this year, and I make two irons off in the middle of the fairway too.
All in a month, right?
it's been very successful, no? and I got the record in the hole-in-ones in the European Tour too, with 10 hole-in-ones in competition, and everything is... the last few months is that my irons, they are like arrows. Nice, very pleased when you play like that, you know, it's good, it's nice to shoot, easy to shoot low. You
know? I have to say, when I saw the video on your first hole-in-one and then I saw it again, I said, no, I already saw that. No, this is
different.
Yeah, yeah. My first hole-in-one was this year in Abu Dhabi, my first week of the year. And then at the Spanish Open and in May, and then the week after at the PGA, BMW PGA in Wentworth, the week after also May.
You know, as long as we're talking about records, I thought this was pretty good. Miguel has played in 655 European Tour events. That is an incredible number. Mark has played in 752 tour events, and that doesn't count the Champions Tour for either one of them. So between the three of us, we played in 1,407 tournaments.
Good shot. Wait, 750?
Yeah.
My goodness, I got 600 around. Yeah, I got 650, I think, in around there.
655 is what.
655, but also I got my tour card here also in 2001, 2002, and me from the middle of 2000 also, and that is probably going to be almost around 700 total. Yeah,
that's fabulous.
How old are you now?
55.
Okay, that's the difference, you know. Oh, yeah, when I get reached 55, I'm going to have the same tournament.
51.
51.
Yeah, I guess I got about 4 years. No, he'll catch me. Yeah.
Tell me about junior golf. When did you guys start playing?
I grew up in this little guy right out here. I grew up in a small town in Nebraska called Laurel, population 920, and we had a little nine-hole course. And like a lot of little boys, I had an older brother who was 11 years older and a dad. And the little course I grew up on had no trees, no irrigation, no bunkers, no nothing, just literally it was a cornfield, and I was 5 years old and just went out and learned how to just grab the club and just start swinging at it. And that's where I learned how to play. And by the time we moved to North Palm Beach, Florida when I was 13 years old, and somehow I had no idea how to hit out of a bunker, and when I got down there I was already better than most every kid in Florida. I chipped out of bunkers when I got to Florida. And when I, you know, got to a bunker with a big lip in it, I was kind of in trouble. But figured it out in a hurry, and we moved to a house right across from the 13th green at North Palm Beach Country Club, and learned how to, you know, blast out of bunkers. And I went around that little nine-hole course six, seven, eight times a day. And if I wasn't, and back then I played barefoot with no shirt and my swim trunks, and when I got hot, I went across the street and jumped in the pool, and then went back to the course. And that's what I did from sun up to sundown.
Kenny, we need a pool in here for next week. Miguel, how about you in junior golf? When did you start playing?
Oh, well, I started playing just after the mechanics history, you know, with 50. I've been caddying on the weekend when I went to school there, on the basic. I had to finish to my studies because we are coming from the poor family. We are seven brothers there, and we had to work, both of us. And then, when I was on my last year on the school with 40 years old, on the weekends I go to caddy on the golf course, Well, my brother, my brother is 12 years older than me, and he's already professional golfer, working there. And then I'm caddy on the weekends. And then when I finish with the school, I finish with the mechanic history, I start working there as a caddy. And then when I start liking golf then, I start swinging the club, and I love it. And then I've been start working on the driving range, collecting the balls, giving the ball to the members who come in to play, to the people that they are playing also. And anyone need a caddy, carrying the bag, collecting the balls, and then between all these things, hitting as much ball as I can and playing. That's my beginnings. It's at hard times. I never get the occasion to play junior golf because at that moment in Spain the golf is it was like two levels, you know, it's like the caddies cannot play with the members and things, you know, and then we have the history is it's different, you know. Caddies, we cannot play with the members there, then you have to go that different way. Probably we can say I'm the last caddy player in Spain. But you know, like Ramon Sota, Severiano Ballesteros, Piñero, Cañizares, Rivero, Garrido, all these guys, all they come the same way. And then the last caddy player coming, no? And for example, Olazabal is the first one who coming from junior golf on the tour. That's more or less the history.
Mark, who were your heroes when you were growing up? Who did you want to be when you were a kid playing 72 holes a day?
Actually, in Nebraska, for some reason, I didn't really watch that much golf on TV. But of course, as soon as we moved to North Palm Beach, Florida, we lived a mile and a half from where Jack Nicklaus lived. And as soon as I got down there and started playing junior golf, the Junior Golf Association down there, I was playing golf against Jack Nicklaus Jr. And I met him almost immediately. And within the first 2 weeks I was down there, I was playing in a junior tournament against Jack Nicklaus Jr. And Jack Nicklaus was watching us play. So I came out of a little farm town in Nebraska, and the next thing I know, Jack Nicklaus is watching me throttle his son in a golf match. And I thought that was pretty cool. I'm like, Golden Bears, you know, in his prime is watching me kick his kid's butt, which I did every single time, by the way. And it was pretty cool. And from that point on, you know, Jack's been my hero, and he treated me great. And the next year, I was 14 years old, and he invited me to play golf at Lost Tree Village with him and Jackie. And, you know, from that point on, obviously, he's been my hero. So,
you know, obviously, you're both very proud sitting up here wearing the Ping logo. And what an amazing American company they are. And Miguel, tell me, you know, when you're standing over a shot and, you know, you've got that Ping club in your hand, what goes through your mind when you think about, you know, what the company has done to help progress your career? What has Ping meant to your career?
Ping for me is Mintalogy. It's the first company which I have a dealing. You know, I mean, before Ping's coming to me with a representative in Spain, the tour up there is Fernando Cabronero. It's in 1987 when I played on the school in La Manga to get my tour card. And I fell by a shot that year, no? But Fernando told me, no problem, here you are. I want you to play with Ping. And before I have my full set of Ping, I have 14 different clubs in the back. With 14 different shafts. and I still can shoot low. Now you can see this day, all the guys say, hey, give me the trauma, give me the thing, I need this one, D2, D3, all these things. And when I listed all these new guys coming with all these things, I say, oh my goodness, what are you got in your head? You don't know nothing about golf. But anyway, no, that's all days. No, now everything's more easy and some facility for all the young people to go there and exploring early than what we're doing before, no? But I started with Ping in 1987. This is my 28th year with them. And since my full set of clubs, you know, with my eyes lit up, wow, all the clubs the same, unbelievable. And since today, you know, I'm very happy, I'm very loyal team. They are very loyal with me, anything I needed, anytime, always they are supporting me. And I'm here with 14 clubs in the back for many years now, and supporting them too, because I think it's a great company with supporting the tour, supporting the players, supporting everything, and also supporting And this, this year, how you call this? Haggin Oaks. Haggin Oaks. Now that helping to get the golf close to all the people, all the juniors, and it's amazing because that is you are the future. It's great to have a such a company like that. What are you doing with Taylor on top? Are you with Callaway? Come on, put it on.
Mark, I know when you tour players go visit the headquarters and look at new clubs and get fitted and things like that, I know they're very excited to have you there. It's got to be a great feeling for you to go in there as well.
It is. I lived in Phoenix for 21 years. My kids were born and raised there. It was so nice to... I lived 30 minutes from the factory there, and all those years to just be able to go in and get, you know, anything I needed, re-gripped or, you know, a new driver or a new shaft or, you know, anything I needed, was just to have the top-notch service and hospitality like that is, you know, and guys travel cross country to come in there and get that kind of treatment, and they give that kind of treatment service to not only tour professionals but amateurs as well. You know, people from all over the country phone up and call up and say, can I come in and get fitted? You know, I want a set of this, and they make appointments and they come in and they get setted. They get on the same equipment that tour players get on, and you know, that's the kind of customer service that Ping gives people, and because it's the best equipment out there. And I've been with Ping since I want to say August of 1984. So. And I was
more young than me.
More years than you, yeah.
I was all over the place.
Believe me, I had to think about it for a minute. So I was all over the place, but just the best equipment.
I'm going to give you each an opportunity to just kind of wrap this up and say something that I may not have asked you, or something other than the silly questions I've asked you. But I just want to give everybody kind of a schedule of what we're going to do. We could probably do this for another hour, but we're going to wrap this up so that you all have an opportunity to take a photo, get an autograph. But how we're going to do this is when we finish here, the gentlemen are going to go right inside to the Super Shop, where we have some air conditioning and some tables, and they're going to sit down and be able to greet you individually. So I'd appreciate it very much if you try not to stop them on the way in, so that we can kind of keep this moving and make sure that everybody gets a chance to talk to them. Again, my thanks to the Morton family in Haggin Oaks, and certainly to these two gentlemen, but I'm going to let each of you wrap it up before we go on inside. What a great pleasure this has been to have you. Miguel?
Well, it's nice to see here, nice to see this in Haggin Oaks. These facilities, it's great. I think it's the way to promote golf and to get the people, golf close to the people, and love the sport. And then, especially where the people, I see different faces, but the young ones, you know, I have to say one thing. I have a tour in Spain. I make 18 tournaments around all Spain, all different communities for kids, you know, and I got people who is in charge to do that there with the kids. Every time I got the chance there, I go there, give a finish to them. And I always tell the same thing to the kids on the prize giving when I'm there. I say, you are the future. You're going to be good golfers, maybe you're going to be good doctors, good lawyers, good whatever you're going to do. But the sport is going to give you mind, freedom, and open mind to anything. And if you know the values, the golf, the sport, especially golf, give you a lot of values. The more you practice, the better you play. You study, you will become whatever you want to do it, but compromise yourself. That's the main thing. And I always tell the same thing to the kids. And this is good values.
Well said, thank you.
Yeah, well said, Miguel. Hard to top that, but it's just this is a fantastic facility. It's super cool to see all these kids out here. You know, you look down here, you just don't see this kind of thing very often in 98 degree heat at 6 o'clock at night. All these kids out here hitting balls. This is amazing. You don't see this in Florida. I promise you that. So very cool to see. It's promising. It's great for the game, and good to see. So, thank you to Haggin Oaks, and thanks for having us, and thanks for coming out to see us,
gentlemen. Really good. and wish you both great success. We hope you're both in the final group come Sunday, and we'll look forward to watching you and cheering you on, and wish you best of success. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, Trace.